Good morning and welcome to East End Online on this second Sunday of Easter. I invite you to take a moment as we prepare to worship together. Just feel yourself present in whatever space you're in. Take a breath. Feel your feet on the floor or flopped on the couch. Feel your arms, whether they're resting on your knees or on a table. Just be in your body. Feel your feelings. Be in this moment. And as we acknowledge and ground ourselves in our bodies and in our physical space, we also acknowledge and ground ourselves in history and give thanks for the land where we gather. And for me, that is the land that is the traditional lands of the Mississauga of the Credit, the Anishinaabeg, Huron-Wendat, and Haudenosaunee people. And in this particular time, we have felt it important to acknowledge the way that illness and pandemic was intentionally spread in Indigenous communities as a form of genocide, that this may be something that is re-triggering. And so we also give thanks for the teachings of care for community, for the prayers, the sacred dances and songs of healing that are shared at this time by Indigenous communities. And we proclaim that settler, migrant, refugee, and Indigenous are called to work together in right relations towards reconciliation and to proclaim that no one is illegal on stolen land. I also give thanks for my colleagues who are sharing in leadership today. Hillary Donaldson, Scott Pietrangelo, Jeff Schisler, Laura Larson, and not currently seen, but later members of the East End Choir who lead our music today. And Sarah Halicus, who is not visible, but is staying in touch over the comments. And Jane Sandin, who is making this technological magic possible. I light this candle as a sign of the light of Christ, that in this season of resurrection, despite the pain and loss around us in the world, that we still proclaim our alleluias and our hopes and signs of resurrection. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Our opening hymn this morning is Morning Has Broken, which is number 409 in Voices United. Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from the word. Sweet the rains new fall, sunlit from heaven, like the first dewfall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness of the wet garden, sprung in completeness where God's feet pass. Ours is the sunlight, ours is the morning, born of the one light, Eden's our play. Praise with elation, praise every morning, God's recreation of the new day.
Let us pray. Holy God, you meet us in these wilderness spaces, holding space for all that we carry. We bring you our doubts and our questions. We bring you our losses and our impatience. We bring you our emptiness and our longing. Meet us where we are. Sit with us in our struggle. Slowly let us settle into our transformed lives. Give us the tools we need for abundant life in this wild and holy place. Amen.
The peace of the risen Christ be with you all. I invite you to share the peace with me using ASL signs that we've been learning in these last few weeks. So to share the peace together, we say, peace be with you. And you can respond by saying, same, same, and also with you. So one more time, I invite you to sign that again with me. Peace be with you and also with you. Our first scripture reading this morning is from the Gospel of John, chapter 20, verses 19 to 31. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the authorities, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails on his hands and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name.
Our second reading is from Romans 16, verses 1 to 16. I commend to you our sister Phoebe, a deacon of the church at Centre, so that you may welcome her in the Lord as is fitting for the saints, and help her in whatever she may require from you, for she has been a benefactor of many, and of myself as well. Greet Prisca and Aquila, who work with me in Jesus Christ, who risked their necks for my life, to whom not only I give thanks, but also all the churches of the Gentiles. Greet also the church in their house. Greet my beloved Epaphras, who was the first convert in Asia for Christ. Greet Mary, who has worked very hard among you. Greet Andronicus and Junia, my relatives who were in prison with me. They are prominent among the apostles, and they were in Christ before I was. Greet Ampliatus, my beloved in the Lord. Greet Urbanus, our co-worker in Christ, and my beloved Stachys. Greet Apelles, who is approved in Christ. Greet those who belong to the family of Aristobulus. Greet my relative Herodian. Greet those in the Lord who belong to the family of Narcissus. Greet those workers in the Lord, Tryphania and Tryphosa. Greet the beloved Persis, who has worked hard in the Lord. Greet Rufus, chosen in the Lord, and greet his mother, a mother to me also. Greet Asyncritus, Phlegion, Hermes, Patrobus, Hermas, and the brothers and sisters who are with them. Greet Philologus, Julia, Nereus, and his sister Olympus, and all the saints who are with you. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All the churches of Christ greet you. The word of hope. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Holy God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts and minds draw us nearer to one another and to you as we seek justice and peace in community. Amen. This passage from Paul's letter to the Roman Church isn't a terribly popular scripture, but it sure speaks to what it's like to be connected to a community. For Paul, preaching the gospel meant putting his life in danger, and these were some of the people who had risked their necks to keep him safe. They were the ones who were committed to being the church. Greet Andronicus and Junia. They always have my back. Greet Prisca and Aquila. They sat on many committees. They said difficult truths. They worked hard for the good of the church. Greet Philologus, who always brought the best quinoa salads to potlucks. Greet Julia, who told me about the places in the world that were hurting, the places that were in need of our prayers and our actions. Greet Nereus, who listened to my fears and my hopes without judgment. Greet Olympus, who planned her own funeral and is surely smiling upon us today. Ministering with you has been my vocation, but it has also been the work of my heart. You know this because you can see my face right now. After close to 12 years, it's hard to say goodbye. I started at Eastminster in 2008. Somehow I still had 80s hair because it was that long ago. Over the years, we have walked together through change. We have become East End. We have faced losses and celebrations. And the process of saying goodbye was interrupted by the COVID-19 pandemic. For the first few weeks, I almost forgot I was leaving. It seemed so busy and so caught up in trying to rebuild church online. And it seems very strange to say goodbye to you over screens and in emails. However, there is a long tradition in the church of letter writing. Paul wrote to the churches that he had labored with in ministry, sending them encouragement and some admonition. And his letters became part of the narrative of the early church. They offer us comfort, reminding us that God's people have always struggled. They have often disagreed and frequently had hurt feelings. Despite or because of all this, the church thrived and grew because they loved each other. And so this is my love letter to you. We grow when we're willing to be authentic and to say hard truths. This has been a hard transition. East End does not always feel like one congregation. This has been a really difficult and very sad part of ministry. We had dreams for this community, and they have been hard to reach. I hope that with new leadership and in the time of post-COVID rebuilding, that East End can come together and be even more the congregation and community that we have hoped for. And of course, in the midst of this struggle, there have also been many moments of celebration and joy, moments when it does feel like we are one community, when we are able to celebrate or grieve together. It has been an honor to be on this journey with you. I thank God for my remembrances of you. I thank God for the times of grieving together, for the meals shared, for coming together in song and in silence when the world is hurting. I thank God for your generosity and your commitment. This work has demanded a stubborn hope and a deep commitment to building a church in the future, a church that does not yet exist. And so we are dreaming of something that we have not yet seen. As you continue this work, it will be important to share the load and encourage new leaders so that no one becomes burnt out or too weary. I call upon you to name your fears and your hopes to one another and to face troubles with honesty spoken in love. I don't know if it's harder or easier doing this staring at a screen. I can say that I anticipated preaching this sermon and seeing your faces. This is not the goodbye that any of us planned for. It is fitting, though, that we're saying goodbye in the context of resurrection. So I often will preach about the metaphorical nature of resurrection, that we can see from the way the post-resurrection Jesus comes through locked doors and isn't always recognized, even by those closest to him, that this is a different experience of Jesus in their midst. And that still matters. But today, what I want to focus on is what this means about endings. Because Jesus came back, but he didn't stay. He wasn't with his disciples in the same way as he had been before. It's always risky in a sermon to compare yourself to Jesus. Look what happened to him. But he does model endings for us really well. In the church, we can be terrible about endings and goodbyes. I started at Eastminster after a beloved longtime minister. And it is hard to be in the shadow of a former leader. It's harder if they stick around. So here's what goodbye looks like for me. It is the hardest thing because I love you. And usually love looks like staying in touch and sticking around. Love means dropping in and reaching out. But in the case of leaving a church, love looks like staying away. Love means not coming back to lead funerals. Love is not visiting or checking in when you're struggling. And that's because congregations need to bond with their new minister and come together as a new incarnation. The more that I stay involved, the harder it will be for East End to find its new direction. It's just hard to enter into a new relationship when you're still sliding into your ex's DMs. I have loved being your minister. Not every day, but overall. I have loved the privilege of being with you in hospital rooms and funeral homes, holding your babies over the font, welcoming you as new members and anointing you with the sign of the cross so that you will never forget you are God's beloved child. It has truly been my honor. I love you too much to mess that up. And so I love you too much to let my ego get in the way. And And so this goodbye means that I will not drop in and not visit, but it does not mean I won't pray for you. It doesn't mean I don't care. It doesn't mean I won't. It doesn't mean I won't miss you dearly. And it doesn't mean I won't say hi in the grocery store either. You don't have to hide behind produce if you see me. But it means things will be different. And so this is my invitation to you. Be real. Feel your feelings. Be with each other in the mess and the discomfort. Be brave and strong. Be open and vulnerable. And I've shared this with you before, and I'm going to share it again. This is Mickey Scott A. Jones. And this poem is an invitation to brave space. Together, we will create brave space, because there is no such thing as a safe space. We exist in the real world. We all carry scars, and we have all caused wounds. In this space, we seek to turn down the volume of the outside world. We amplify the voices that fight to be heard elsewhere. We call each other to more truth and love. We have the right to start somewhere and continue to grow. We have the responsibility to examine what we think we know. We will not be perfect. This space will not be perfect. It will not always be what we wish it to be, but it will be our brave space together. And we will work side by side. Our hearts are doing many difficult things all at once these days. And so be gentle and loving with yourself. And at the same time, the world is waiting, and we are called to find ways to pass the mic to those who are silenced, especially in these days, to sing through our fears, and to find ways of being the people of God in a context we never imagined. So keep making brave spaces, be authentic, listen for the places that God is calling you to be active in the world. So many things are limited right now, but you still have your heart and your voice. And so keep loving and keep singing. Amen.
Sorry, tech difficulties. Sorry to ruin the moment. We'll be right.
Till all the chairs are empty and all the bellies filled, till no one hurts or steals or lies and no more blood is spilled. God has a work for us to do. God has a work for us to do. Till God's will is done and all things are made new. God. sealed, till no one hurts or steals or lies, and no one blood is spilled. God has work for us to do. God has work for us to do, till God's will is done and all things are made new. God has work for us, work for us to do. Till age and race and gender no longer separate, till COVID press and politics are free of greed and hate. God has work for us to do. God has work for us to do. Till God's will is done, all things are made new. God has work for us. In tenement and mansion, in factory, farm, and mill, in boardroom and in billiard hall, in woods where time stands still,
in classroom, church, and office, in shops or on the street, in every place where people thrive or starve or hide,
God has work for us. God has work for us.
By sitting by the bedside to hold his trembling hands, by speaking for a power
by praying through our doing, and singing though we fear, by trusting that the seed we sow will bring us harvest near. God has work for us to do. God has work for us to do. Till God's will is done and all things are made new. God has work for us. God has work for us to do. God has work for us to do. Till God's will is done and all things are made new. God has work for us. Work for us to do. Work for us to do.
Thank you so much for that. It's so beautiful to see just over the years all of the experiences that we've had together, and I will miss you deeply. Thank you. Thank you to everyone who contributed photos to that. It was beautiful to see all of those babies over the font who are so much bigger now, and weddings that I officiated at, and all of the moments. I go like this a lot.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
And so, as we reflect, on God's generosity in our lives, on the ways that we have been blessed, we are called to give back, and we give back in many ways. We're giving back through volunteering, through our prayers, through the ways we help our neighbors. And we give thanks for those contributing to the work of the church in all of those ways, as well as those contributing through PAR, through pre-authorized remittance, or on Canada Helps. the expenses of the church continue even when the building is closed and many of our other sources of revenue cease to exist because the building is, of course, not safe to occupy by groups that are renting. So we are especially grateful for those contributions that continue. And as we reflect with gratitude on the ways that we are blessed with generosity and that we are called to give, we'll sing our offering hymn together.
Good morning. Our offertory hymn will be Voices United, number 183, We Meet You, O Christ.
We meet you, O Christ, in many a guise. Your image we see in simple and wise. You live in a palace, exist in a shack. We see you, the gardener, a tree on our back. In millions alive, away and abroad, involved in our life, you live down the road. In plays and in systems, you long to be free. We see you, O Jesus, still bearing your tree. We hear you, O Christ, in agony cry. For freedom you march, in riots you die. Your face in the papers we read and we see. The tree must be planted by human decree. You choose to be made at one with the earth. The dark of the grave prepares for your birth. Your death is your rising, creator, your word. The tree springs to life and the hope is restored.
Let us pray. Holy God, we give thanks for the gifts offered, for the ways that we have been able to come together to continue ministry in your world, and for the ways that we have been blessed with so many gifts, gifts of volunteer time and love, gifts of talents, and gifts offered, and financial gifts that enable the church to continue the work. Amen. As we gather in prayer, we will continue our practice of inviting prayer requests through the comments. And so I will invite you a little bit later in the church to share your laments and your hopes, your moments of gratitude, and anything that is weighing upon your heart. Let us pray. God of resurrection, this Easter season feels different. Help us to feel you with us when we are in locked rooms and spaces where we close our doors out of fear. Hold our confusion, our questions, and our knowing. Guide us to find what is true for each of us, to listen to our intuition, and to be in touch with what is good and right. In these days, when so many things feel risky and frightening, hold space for our fear and comfort us. Meet our doubts with compassion and understanding. Holy God, our eyes are open to your love and grace surrounding us. Our ears open to hear you calling us to new challenges. Our minds open to new possibilities in an unknown context. We experience you standing in our midst. We celebrate your presence with us as you remind us that we are never alone. We pray for our congregation, saying goodbye in a different way. You are with us in this ending, and you will be with us in the new beginnings. You are with leaders working to keep the church functioning, with staff creating new ways of being the church, and with all of us in these days of saying goodbye. We bring the prayer concerns that weigh heavily on our hearts today, along with our gratitude and our laments. In our ecumenical prayer cycle, we pray with Armenia, Azerbaijan, and Georgia. In Shining Waters region, we pray with Bracebridge United Church, King City United Church, and Keswick Ravenshoe Pastoral Charge. And in our East End prayer cycle, we pray with our local city councillors, MPPs, and MPs who are working so hard right now to try to bring the resources together for those, especially those who are struggling the most. We pray for thousands of Bangladeshi garment workers without work, food, and without a safety net. We continue to pray for Sarah Briones Clark, who is showing signs of recovery from COVID, but still in ICU, and pray for her family. We pray for those working in healthcare and those who are keeping shops open. We remember Evelyn Turner and others who we name now in silence or aloud. Jeff names prayers for my Aunt Karen, who is at PSW in a home. Keep her safe. Pray for a prayer of thanks for Mary and Harry, my parents, who have been such an important part of the congregation. And thanks to Denise's generous participation and gentle presence.
Thank you.
Pray for Fernando in hospital. Catherine's prayers for her brother John, who finished radiation on Friday. Anne names prayers for her mom and dad in a home that has COVID-19. For those, Avery names prayers for those utilizing the shelter system at this time in the downtown core. Let them know that they are not forgotten. Lori names prayers for the community in my sister's apartment building where there are some long-term care workers who have been diagnosed with COVID. Kathy names prayers for my sister Mary in a retirement community that is full of COVID-19. Prayers for Marie, who has, at 95 years old, been diagnosed with COVID-19. And Wendy names prayers for baby Blake, still in the NICU. Scott names prayers for wisdom for those who protest against the quarantine. May they see the gravity of their situation. Amen. Yeah. May God grant us all wisdom to make good choices in this difficult time. Marian says prayers for you and your family. Thank you, Marian. In this time, we pray for all of those who are in retirement homes and seniors communities, seeing how hard they have been hit and the devastation that they have been facing. Brenda Percy names prayers for Helen Dunlop. You're not alone. And Susan names thankful that my friend Mike has recovered from her fever. Amen. Yes. And give thanks for those who are recovering and those who are being released from hospital, as well as lamenting and grieving those who have died. Take take a moment of silence to reflect on whatever is weighing on your heart, whatever you need God to be in your life this week. Pat names prayers for Joan Daynard and Don Morehouse. Yes. And so God of resurrection, we cry out to you from a world where we know the Good Friday of innocent suffering and death. We know the pain of smothering hope and of dreams dissolved. We stumble amongst the tombs in our lives and long to find them empty. God of resurrection, we long to sense your presence and feel the pulse of your power. Bring Easter into our hearts and our lives. For now Christ is risen, planting life and love in the weary soil of our lives and restoring hope to the lost. And so in the name of the child who taught us that love is stronger and destruction and death, we celebrate the empty tomb and we join the group together.
Hi, everyone. Before we move into our time of saying goodbye to Sarah, she has just said goodbye to us, I'd like to share a few announcements. We will have coffee hour after the service if you would like to connect with each other or with Reverend Sarah. And the link should be in the chat. And we're also saying goodbye to someone this week who has also served our Glen Rhodes and East End United Congregation for a very long time. Edith Shand is retiring, and we celebrate her incredible service to this congregation. She has been the property manager and most recently the treasurer. She has worked extensively with the food bank and the trustees and on council and sang in the choir. And thank you so much, Edith, for your years and years of dedication to our people of God. Anne McElraith will take over Edith's duties as treasurer. So we welcome you, Anne, into that role. And yes, thank you, Edith. We hope to still see you around. And next week, we welcome Reverend Deborah Schneider into role as our supply minister, and we will do a full welcome for her next week. This is a very emotional day for a lot of us. And Sarah has meant so much to me. I was going through a lot of stuff, a lot of my cleaning out while I'm isolated at home, and I found a lot of materials from 5 years ago when I just started working at East End and had some ideas that were a little bit out there, like my Gospel According to Justin Bieber service and my pageant. And I was afraid at that time and wasn't sure if I could or should do those things, but Sarah always said yes and encouraged me to take risks and trusted me. And a great leader is one that always makes other people shine, that empowers people and holds space for people and trusts people and advocates for people. So Sarah, thank you so much for growing me into a better leader. It's really meant a lot. This summer, Sarah and I were at Skylight Festival, which is at Five Oaks. It's a United Church of Canada festival. And we met a woman named Chris Davies. And Chris Davies has something amazing. And the amazing thing that she has created are queer clergy trading cards. And I am going to share with you what those look like. So, we're on the wrong slide. Here we go. So queer clergy trading cards are for queer clergy because they are superheroes. And it's because being queer and clergy is hard. They're here changing the world and in a lot of places where the world feels titled against them. So this celebrates the queer clergy around the world. Chris Davies is clergy in the States. And she also says, God calls us into ministry, not to spite our queer identity, but because of it. It is the shifting nature of the church out there, and queer clergy are uniquely positioned to reach out across divides and think outside the box. With our colleagues in ministry, we're ready to take on the future of Christianity and add voices unheard and stories untold from our own experience and that of our community. And we thank Sarah for doing so much for making our congregation affirming and living into that affirming world. So a number of staff have filled out the form and we're making Sarah into a queer clergy trading card. So that should be done in a couple of months. Sarah will have her final say on what that looks like, but I just wanted to unveil that here today. And something special that the congregation created is this word cloud. And we had hundreds of submissions for words. So what a word cloud is when words show up more than once, they get bigger and bigger and bigger. So as you can see, this is what you said about Sarah. And the things you've said most is that she is compassionate and funny and kind and strong and fierce and real, eloquent, passionate, brave, caring, loyal, thought-provoking, social justice-seeking. And all the words are part of this heart. And Sarah, when we're back and able to see each other in person, we look forward to giving you a framed copy of this heart. So thank you for everyone who shared their love for Sarah in this way. And up next, I'm going to welcome Ron to share a little something from the congregation.
Good morning. To everything, there is a season, a time for every purpose under heaven. Sarah, we have walked with you for many seasons. We have, as individuals and as a congregation, grown in our faith as you have ministered among us. You have challenged us and stretched us in our understanding of who we are called to be and what we are called to do in the world with your knowledge, compassion, humor, and wisdom. You have taught us how to build community. With you, we have drawn the circle ever more wider. You have blessed us with your laughter and tears and shown us that, that both are indeed holy. We thank you for your courage to share with us your full humanity as an example of how we are invited to bring our whole selves to God and to each other. We thank you for your fierce and loving sense of justice, which has kept us on the right path through these challenging, exciting, and disturbing times. We have traveled with you for 12 years, and now our paths must diverge. Although they may take parallel and at times intertwining routes, we pray that God give you strength for the journey as you discern and search in new ways of which you are called to serve. Go with our love, our respect, our blessings, and the gift of a small token of our appreciation, which are in many places both digital and analog, and that purse will come to you at an appropriate time. Thank you very much, Sarah. God bless.
Okay, more tech problems. Hold on 1 second. Thank you for your patience.
Well, thank you, Ron, for your words, and thank you, Jane. And that's just so beautiful. And I'm so excited to be on a queer clergy trading card. That's like a life goal. And yes, I'm so touched. That's just thrilling. I thought you were gonna say, we went to Skylight and here's like a picture of Sarah and I talking to a frog, which was an important moment too. But I forgot about the trading card. So thank you. And I'm just so touched. I know that you're doing something else.
Thanks, Sarah. Thank you for that and that little bit of levity. And here are a few more messages from the congregation.
Pam, and I am chair of East End Regional Ministry. And I just wanted to take a moment of your time publicly to express how grateful I am to Reverend Sarah and our worship team during this rather surreal time. I know that this is not the way we anticipated saying goodbye to Sarah. I anticipated some tears and sadness and good wishes and a lot of hugs. Well, I think we have the first three, even if it's virtually, but the hugs are going to have to wait, but there will be hugs. I recognize that Sarah at this moment is not able to say goodbye as she would have intended. Sarah was beginning that journey of goodbyes when the COVID-19 pandemic really struck us all. I do hope that during coffee time with Sarah, you've had a chance to have a coffee or maybe a soothing herbal tea and a chat with Reverend Sarah and Reverend Jane and whoever else might have been hanging out. I know I've enjoyed meeting people's pets and having quiet conversation and a check-in, you know, just to see how we're doing. Sarah's sermons are always inspiring. Her activism is undying, and she looks at the Bible and its passages in a way that is so relevant to our world. Reverend Sarah has left her impression on so many of us, and I'm so grateful to have worked with Sarah these many years. We have all benefited from Sarah's wisdom, kindness, and compassion. So simply, thank you, Sarah, for your leadership. I also want to assure you in this time of transition that the staff and council continue to work for you and with you just in different ways. We're learning new ways to communicate, and we're reaching out using old ways like the telephone just to have a chat. Imagine that. Thank you for bearing with us while we work out some of the glitches. And we are going to keep communicating with you, checking in about what is happening now and in the future. But right now, in this time, let's just take a moment to send our good thoughts, energy, and intention Reverend Sarah's way, wishing her the very best for this new phase in her journey. Thank you for listening. Stay safe. Stay healthy. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Your office is packed. You're ready to go. You're standing here outside the church. We hate to let you go and say goodbye. But the dawn is breaking, it's early morn. Your future's waiting, it's calling you on. Already we're so lonesome we could cry. So love us and smile for us. Tell us that you'll pray for us. Hold us in your heart, never let us go. 'Cause you're leaving, not without pain. We don't know when we'll see you again. Oh, Sarah, we hate to let you go. There's so many times when we've been down, so many times you've been around. We'll tell you now, it's meant everything. Every Sunday morning we'll think of you. Every protest march we'll look for you. When we meet again we'll hug you and we'll say, we love you and we smile for you, knowing that you go forth as you, shining your light wherever you may go. 'Cause you're leaving, not without pain. We don't know when we'll see you again. Oh, Sarah, we hate to let you go. Now the time has come to leave us. After all the times you've really seen us, we'll close our eyes. You'll be on your way. We'll dream about days to come, when you'll come back and share some fun. We'll laugh and cry all those memories we made. We love you and we'll smile for you, knowing that you go forth as you, shining your light wherever you may go. You're leaving, not without pain. We don't know when we'll see you again. Oh, Sarah, we hate to let you go. Cause you're leaving, not without pain. We don't know when we'll see you again. Oh, Sarah, we hate to let you go. We hate to let you go. We hate to let you go.
Hey, Sarah, I just wanted to take a second to say a great big thank you. Thank you for everything that you have done at Eastminster and at East End United. You are an incredible leader. You have so many wise and encouraging and thought-provoking things to say every single time I hear you speak. You are a bastion of patience, and you are very understanding, and you really, really walk the talk. You walk what you speak. And I think that is one of the most wonderful things about you, and one of the most wonderful things that you bring and have brought to your ministry. You lead by example, and I, for one, very much appreciate that and always have. So now, as you take your next steps into wherever you are going in your journey, I wish you well. And I hope we do keep in touch, and I'm sure you will keep in touch with all of us. And it ain't goodbye, it's see you soon.
Hey, Sarah. I know that we already had to say goodbye just a short little while ago, but I still wanted to make a point to celebrate you and the ministry that you've done for over a dozen years at the East End United Regional Ministry. I just was thinking, like, how amazing and wonderful is it that there are youth in the church who have known you as their minister all these years? That when they picture a minister, they picture you in all of your queerness, with all of your passion, and the fact that they grew up in a church where there was a woman as a leader for so long. And yes, what I'm saying is that your presence alone is a gift to the church. But beyond that, your gift to the church is so much more than that. It's because of how you really show up with a lot of love, with a lot of incredible quick wit, and a real concern for ensuring that our faith as Christians remains inspired and accountable to what the Spirit is up to at the margins of society. I am lucky that even with this goodbye, I get to continue to call you my lifelong ministry colleague and a friend. God has blessed you with so many gifts, and those in the future who will be receiving those gifts will be very lucky people indeed. Congratulations, Sarah, and farewell.
Hi, Sarah. Heather and Michelle here. We wanted to add our well wishes to your videos. Just wanted to say that we found Eastminster Church and you at a time in our lives that our faith was really shaken. And you not only brought us back to the church, but you restored our faith in people in a lot of ways. And we think that you are everything that we were looking for in a church. You just embody honesty. You are socially conscious. You are diverse. You are kind. You are funny and true to yourself. And when we think back on what you've given us, words aren't enough to really express it. You helped us say goodbye to Stella, and then you helped us welcome our other four children into the world and into the church.
We're going to miss you so much. To us, you are the church.
Good luck.
Hi, Sarah. I think the most valuable thing that I've learned from you recently is about God's discernment. I remember last summer when we went out to lunch at the Thai place across the street, and I'd asked you about how you got into ministry and how you discern God's leading in your life. And I remember your answer very clearly. You said that sometimes you have to be doing and trying things and doing the work and the activities to best be able to figure out God's leading in your life. That might be obvious to some people, but I think I really needed to hear that. You had some great advice, and I have put it to use a number of times, so thank you. And thank you for all your encouragement. Just me trying to figure out God's leading in my own life, and either starting prayer groups or signing up for the Lay Worship Leader program. I have no idea where my journey will lead me, but I wanted you to know that you played a vital part in it. So I'm very grateful and will always be grateful for that. So thank you. And wishing you God's abundant blessings on your journey.
And now we will sing together from More Voices, number 59. Hallelujah, praise to God. All three verses.
Hallelujah, praise to God. Hallelujah, praise to God. Praises, high praises we bring you, O God. Hallelujah, praise to God. Songs of joy sing out to God. Songs of joy sing out to God. Dancing and singing we praise you, O God. Songs of joy sing out to God. Beat the drum, sing out to God. Beat the drum, sing out to God. Praises, high praises we bring you, O God. Beat the drum, sing out to God.
Now, as you go forth into the world and into your lives, go forth with a daring spirit to be brave. Go forth with an open heart to be vulnerable. Go into the world and into your lives, knowing that you are loved. And go forth with my blessing, this blessing of hope for the future of community, this blessing of love and gratitude for all that we have been together and all that you have been for me. And go forth with this blessing of God that surrounds us, that gives us comfort, that challenges us, that invites us to be our whole selves, to feel our real feelings, and to love without boundary, and to keep our hearts open. So go forth remembering today and always that you are God's beloved child.
Amen. And we'll sing our song, Blessing God Be With You. And if I have to stop singing, you just keep singing at home.
God be with you. God be with you until we meet again. God be with you. God be
you keep singing.
This is the sound of one.